I would like to next introduce Andre Yagaru. Andre received his MD degree from Carol Davila University of Medicine in Bucharest, Romania, and then came to the US and did his internship at Drexel and residency, where he was chief resident at the University of Southern California. He then came to Stanford and finished his residency and did a fellowship here. And we were able to recruit him to our faculty in 2009. Andre is now professor of radiology and chief of nuclear medicine and molecular imaging. Andre has over 160 papers, 7 book chapters, and 1 book. I wanted to do a shout out for Andre's book called PET MRI in Oncology. He has received many awards for his research, teaching, and clinical work, and has served in a number of leadership positions. Thank you, Andre, for joining us today.
Thank you, Norbert, for the very kind introduction. This is not about any of us, it's about Sam. I want to thank Dean Miner, Gary, and Joe for inviting me to speak today. I'm speaking on behalf of all of us in nuclear medicine, and I want to thank Aruna for not just her extraordinary words, but also for being with us here today. And thank you all for joining. As Dean Miner said, what was another extraordinary thing about Sam is that he was not just an amazing researcher, but he was also an exceptional clinician. And I think that that will be reflected in the next slides, again, on behalf of all of us in nuclear medicine. A number of years ago, we were planning to play a little game asking our trainees to guess who wrote what about why we went into nuclear medicine. And this is what Sam's words were. I will let you read it. I would also emphasize what he says about the significant patient interaction and being a hybrid of imaging and medicine. And for a small subspecialty that sometimes was derided as unclear medicine, the fact that Sam went into it, the fact that Sam's is extraordinary, scientist and clinician came from nuclear medicine and transcended across multiple imaging disciplines and along medicine and other areas in the world is so extraordinary, and we are so proud. This is an image from 2007-2008, a few years after Sam joined. He already grew nuclear medicine at that point, and I'm using it to acknowledge some of the colleagues from that time who since have moved to other institutions such as Dave, Eric, Sharif, Andy, as well as those who retired, like Dr. Goris and Dr. McDougall. Sam was truly at the intersection of everything we did in nuclear medicine, be it clinical nuclear medicine, being nuclear medicine clinical research, and also recruiting people into nuclear medicine. So I'm going to speak about each of these briefly in the next few minutes. Let's start with clinical nuclear medicine. As Norbert said earlier, Dr. Glazer, who was the chair before Sam, had the vision of expanding beyond body CT and MRI at RSL into what was emerging then, the field of molecular imaging. And we were so fortunate that Gary and Norbert and the others at the time were able to recruit Sam to move from UCLA to Stanford. And this is a rendering of the clinic that Sam built together with others and translated into reality. It was not easy, it took time, but his perseverance made it happen. It started with the radiochemistry expansion, the first cyclotron in 2003, and I cannot express how thrilled I am to hear about the second one becoming reality. Then the Clark Center and the largest small animal imaging facility in the world. And then the culmination of these efforts, the opening of the new nuclear medicine and molecular imaging clinic in 2010. This was a picture from the opening, and Sam participated along with everyone else and dedicated this clinic to our patients and their families. A decade later, we are proud to say that the equipment has been renewed and also that the space was renovated to become another part of Sam's vision, Theranostics. And these are pictures from the pre-opening events that took place about a month and a half ago, where Aruna kindly participated as well. This also led to the establishment of a fantastic team that's leading the Theranostics Clinic, Karina, Kat, Valentina, Corinne, Tina, and Elena. And we, of course, the others are supporting everything that goes on in the Theranostics space. Stanford now nuclear medicine has presence in various locations, and this has been translated into the growth of the number of patient visits that we see. Again, a testimony to the vision that Sam had for clinical nuclear medicine. As far as nuclear medicine clinical research, there's so much going on. Sam, driven directly by Sam, entrusted us to also take on our own projects. I'm only going to highlight two of them. FPPRGD2, a dimer looking at angiogenesis. And in a very cruel twist, Sam was researching glioblastoma multiforme years before Milan had the disease. And this is from one of the research programs in GBM, where we were able to show that as early as 1 week after studying bevacizumab, one can tell if someone will respond, as is the case here, or if someone will not respond, as is the case in this other example. Sam was very generous with people in his lab. This is a picture from a few years ago, and this is the probe that was developed by Sam with help from some of the postdocs, but it was his vision to target this integrin alpha V beta 6 for various processes, fibrosis in cancer, fibrosis in other etiologies. And it is not easy to translate this to do first in human studies, but with his guidance and vision and support, the nuclear medicine team, together with basic scientists, are able to put this first in human PET radiopharmaceuticals and hopefully change the way we take care of patients, in this case, pancreatic cancer patients. The number of active research trials in nuclear medicine has increased over time, and so did the funding. This excludes the funding coming from MIPS. It's purely nuclear medicine clinical translational research. And I don't think there are too many centers in the world that can have on a daily basis access to so many first-in-human or early-stage PET radiopharmaceuticals. The first five are for prostate cancer alone, and there are many others that are in the pipeline, so we will carry on Sam's legacy. Sam also supported access for patients to things that were under development and not FDA approved yet. So more than 700 patients had access to things that otherwise they would have had to pay for, but at Stanford they were offered at no charge again, because Sam had the vision of offering things to from bench to bedside, truly in a way that was easily accessible for patients. I want to acknowledge the staff and the scientists in our radiochemistry facility, particularly Gunilla and Bin. This started as a small operation in 2006, and currently there are more than 30 INDs, which is quite an achievement, and it could not have been done without their support. I want to acknowledge from the early years, Dave, Fred, Rona, Muru, and then the current team that Bin with Gunilla were able to put together and grow. And of course, you cannot do research without the clinical coordinators. I want to acknowledge them as well. I want to focus the last part of my presentation on the people in nuclear medicine. And beyond being a fantastic scientist and clinician, Sam was a leader, and he was someone who could bring people together. And this is probably one of the most important parts of his legacy. I'm going to start with some quotes. These are our technologists. Paolo is our manager. Lou has been here for many years, and Nora is the most senior technologist for decades being at Stanford. And you can see in their words the impact that Sam had on them. Respect is a word that we use frequently when we talk about Sam, and so is being kind and being caring. You can read more about this. The same from residents. Karina and Judy were residents here, and you can say, you can see their words about Sam. As a clinician, Sam was available 24/7. And I remember being a resident, calling him in the middle of the night as well, but these are from Ryan and Edison. And Edison wrote something that I witnessed as well, midnight call to Sam, and Sam saying, Edison, give me 5 minutes, I'm just going to walk over from the office. So being not just a fantastic researcher, but a consummate clinician as well. Speaking about residency, this was a program in nuclear medicine established in 1973. Accredited by ACGME in 1975, and with a very high success rate. The program is now led by my colleague, Ben Frank. This is the first program in the country that combines nuclear medicine and diagnostic radiology, leading to dual board certification. And these are our current residents. Caitlin was the first trainee that was recruited in the dual pathway program. Nuclear medicine was studied at Stanford in 1947 by Dr. Newell, himself a pioneer and a well-recognized leader in the field. And he was followed by Dr. Joe Chris, who led the nuclear medicine division for many decades. They were followed by other luminaries. And when Sam came at Stanford in 2003, these were the faculty present here themselves, luminaries. Dr. Gore is known for computers in medicine, cardiovascular imaging, therapies. Dr. Ross McDougall, recognized as a giant in the field of thyroid disease, and George, a pioneer of PET. With his modesty, Sam said that we're here on the shoulders of giants, but himself, he was a giant. And what he did here, he took what was already a well-recognized group and built upon it. And this is who works in nuclear medicine now at Stanford. Again, a testimony for Sam's vision for growth and for inclusion at the top row. My colleagues on the adult side, Helen leads a pediatric nuclear medicine program. George and Minal are the VA, and Henry, Aaron, and Christina help us. Sam won innumerable awards, and these are just a few from the Society of Nuclear Medicine. And the most recent one in 2018, the Kassen Prize. If you didn't listen to Sam give that talk, please do. It is inspirational. But Sam was, as Aruna said, was more proud of his trainees and collaborators awards. And these are just a few from clinical nuclear medicine. It's a big shout out to Andy Kwan, who won two of these awards. But these are the Image of the Year and the Ant Mini Image of the Year, which I refer to as the Oscars of imaging. And it is remarkable that four times during Sam's tenure, the clinical nuclear medicine at Stanford was able to get these awards. This was quoted as well by Joe, but perhaps in a different form, in the inaugural series in the Journal of Nuclear Medicine between Johannes Ternin and Sam. Sam said, we shouldn't be celebrating how full our hospitals are. We should celebrate when our hospitals are empty. And again, a vision that he articulated so well in Precision Health. So us, clinical faculty and trainees and technologists at nuclear medicine, we are committed not just to continue Sam's legacy, but also to emulating Sam's values. And some of them are to be humble, gentle, generous, fair, kind, and transparent. Everybody misses Sam, not just us in nuclear medicine, but the entire department. We think of him. This is our small memorial in the nuclear medicine clinic. We pass by every day, and he's with us every day. And I will just end with this quote from the end of his plenary talk when he received the Kassen Award, and particularly how he expects everyone to treat each other with respect, whether we direct family or work family. I think that that's an incredible legacy that Sam left with us. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Andre, for a wonderful talk. Much appreciated.